This personal watercraft leaps, dives, and barrel rolls with the waves, but it doesn't capsize. It's been engineered to return to an upright position in the water. And when it comes to the fun factor, this diving watercraft leaves other recreational boats in its wake. To make the diving watercraft's passenger cabin, a worker sprays a gel coat onto a form and covers it with fiberglass. A computer-driven router then carves into marine-grade plywood to produce structural backing for the sides of the cockpit. A worker slathers adhesive putty onto the plywood part and applies more adhesive to the fiberglass cockpit. He presses the plywood to the glued areas of the cockpit and brushes resin onto the front of the plywood. After cutting the cockpit section in two, the crew glues the parts to the inside of the fuselage. The fabricating team applies adhesive putty to the cone-shaped bumper known as the sacrificial nose. They slide it onto the front of the fuselage and then screw the bumper in place temporarily while the adhesive sets. Another worker sands all the fiberglass parts of the watercraft to remove bumps and blemishes. This piece is the engine hatch. The team bolts the aluminum scaffold to the floor of the fuselage. This is a test fit to confirm that the dimensions are exactly right. As they install the scaffold, they use dummy wing shafts to correctly position it within the vessel. They confirm that the dimensions are right and that the scaffold sits plumb to the base of the watercraft. The next team inserts the hatch frame in the rim around the cockpit. They'll bond the frame in place later with a liquid plastic and adhesive putty. After priming the sanded surface of the watercraft, team members lower the 300 horsepower engine into the hatch. This is a dry fit to confirm everything lines up correctly. They'll eventually remove the engine for the final paint and artwork. As the dry fit continues, they connect the air tubes to the snorkel fins that deliver air to the engine. The engine hatch has by now also been primed, and they fit it to the diving watercraft's main body. The crew verifies that the hatch sits flush with the rest of the fuselage. A worker installs the exhaust outlet into the hole at the rear of the watercraft. Crew members slide elevator fins into bushings at the back. These fins will control the pitch axis of the watercraft. Next, they install the jet propulsion system. Back to the cockpit, the crew bolts the control pedals to the floor and run cables to the jet propulsion unit, the elevator fins, and the steering system. They reinstall the dive fin scaffold, which has been powder coated in a yellow color. The crew connects the dive fins to the scaffold. They situate the control panel just above the control pedals. They run a metal linkage from the dive fins to a control stick. They then test the control stick and confirm it moves the dive planes easily and correctly. Bucket seats made of lightweight carbon fiber minimize the load for added speed. They tuck a rubber gasket into the framework for the clear canopy that will surround the occupants. They add a bead of sealant where the gasket mates to the window frame. The vessel canopy is made of thick aircraft-grade acrylic. It's been tinted to repel the sun's rays and keep the temperature cooler in the cockpit. The back canopy serves as a hatch for accessing the cockpit. Finally, an artist does a custom paint job and makes the fuselage look fierce. With the mechanical components reinstalled, this diving watercraft is ready to hit the water. Fasten your seatbelt, it should be quite a ride. A diesel exhaust fluid, or DEF tank heater, is a device which prevents diesel exhaust fluid from freezing. Diesel exhaust fluid is a solution sprayed into the exhaust system of a vehicle with a diesel engine to break down dangerous polluting chemicals the tailpipe would otherwise emit. A worker programs a robotic bender to bend the cut tube to the required shape. These bends are so complex that no traditional manually operated bending machine would be able to do them this accurately. The heater sits right inside the DEF holding tank. That's why manufacturers use stainless steel rather than ordinary steel for this tubing. Stainless steel better resists the corrosiveness of the DEF fluid. At the next station, a worker inserts the bent tube into the tank heater sensor unit. The tube fits through openings in the sensor unit's header. When connected by a cable to the vehicle's computer, the sensor unit detects the level, temperature, and quality of the DEF. Next, the worker puts the tubing in a punch press, which shapes the ends. He puts those shaped ends in a bender which curves them. Another tube made the same way siphons DEF from the holding tank to a device that sprays the fluid on the exhaust stream. He installs a rubber O-ring onto this siphon tube and applies lubricant. He installs the tube into the header, and the O-ring fits into a notch. The worker then installs a bracket at the base of the heater, riveting it to the tubing. The bracket holds a rubber grommet that secures the heater in place inside the DEF tank. Further up, he rivets on a second bracket to stabilize the sensor tube that runs down the center of the sensor unit. This prevents the tube from rattling. Then, he installs the return tube, which feeds any excess unsprayed DEF back to the holding tank. Retaining brackets apply pressure to all the O-rings, sealing the tube connections against leaks. He flips the heater over to attach the drain tube, which is the bottom half of the return tube. He caps all the tubes to keep them clean until the heater is installed in the vehicle. He attaches a nylon filter to the siphon tube, securing it in place with a retaining clip. As the siphon tube draws the DEF from the holding tank toward the sprayer, the filter removes contaminants such as sand. Finally, this rubber grommet snaps into the bracket at the base of the heater. The grommet fits over a raised bump on the tank floor, holding the unit securely in place. Once connected to the vehicle's computer, the heater keeps the diesel exhaust fluid from freezing, no matter how cold the weather. Looking to get high on a new water sport? Well, you literally can riding a flying water bike. It attaches with a long hose to the back of a jet ski, elevating you up to almost 40 feet above the water, where you can perform aerial flips and spins. The jet ski's water thrust feeds three jet nozzles on the flying water bike. One propels the bike upward. The other two feed jet control nozzles that maneuver the bike. After masking the ends of the splitter, a worker sprays the completed frame, jet control nozzles, and other aluminum parts with powder coat. This helps protect against corrosion. The parts go into an oven for up to a half hour to bake the powder coat to a shiny finish. Then, workers install an aluminum cam lock to securely fasten the fire hose to the coupling. Another worker attaches the remaining components to the frame, First, he screws in the pair of foot plates on which the rider stands. Then, he bolts the bottom half of each plate to the parallel support bars, and the top half to just ahead of the cam lock. He mounts a padded knee rest to the support bars. It can be easily repositioned to accommodate the rider's height. On each unpainted end of the splitter, he installs an internal support ring, then a precision-fit nylon bushing, and an external support ring which he screws to the splitter. The worker slides the jet control nozzle housing over the bushing and screws it to the internal support ring. The two control nozzles maneuver the water bike. To ascend, you pull back gradually on both of them simultaneously. To descend, you push forward on both. To spin, you move one forward and one back. And to do a backflip, you yank both control nozzles all the way back. He assembles the water bike's body. It's made of molded polyethylene with a waterproof urethane pad to cushion the front of the rider's body. The seat is made of the same padded material. Both pad and seat attach with plastic clips. The hollow body is completely watertight, which is why the bike floats. The final step is to mate the body to the frame. The completed water bicycle weighs 30 pounds. Once connected to a jet ski with a fire hose, this water bike flies at a speed of up to 20 miles per hour. By maneuvering the jet nozzles, it does backflips, multiple spins, and even dives 20 feet underwater. Solar streetlights take energy from the sun during the day, store it, and then use it to shine brightly at night. So even when the sun sets, they still provide light. Manufacturing begins with the assembly of an LED circuit board. The technician places the optics or lenses onto the aluminum board and adds a silicone foam gasket for waterproofing. She secures the assembly with a stainless steel plate. This completes the solar streetlight's LED board. The next worker assembles the LED board to the base of an aluminum heat sink. It will disperse excess heat from the LED board. He uses several screws to secure the LED board to the heatsink. He installs the driver, which will provide power to the LED board. Once in place, he connects the LED driver to the input power lead. He now builds the decorative housing. He screws aluminum tiers together. He applies adhesive to the upper inner rim. He inserts an optically clear polycarbonate lens, and the flange adheres to the adhesive-coated rim. He screws the LED heatsink assembly to an aluminum lid. He now applies a special adhesive to the outside rim of the light fixture housing. He presses foam tubing onto the area. Once compressed by the lid, it will provide a watertight seal. With everything in an upside-down position, he lowers the assembly over the LED heatsink and screws it to the lid. A technician plugs the fixture into an electrical testing unit. He confirms that all the LEDs are illuminating and that there are no electrical issues. The manufacturers then transfer the light fixture to a solar light factory. Upon arrival here, a technician does more testing to verify that its function hasn't been compromised along the way. The team is now ready to add the solar power system to the LED streetlight. A technician programs the solar charge and load controller. Another team member places the battery that will hold the solar charge into a vented cabinet. He connects the battery to a side clip and ground wire. He tucks insulating foam into the sides and connects a load fuse to the battery wiring. He plugs the controller into the battery. In addition to regulating the battery charge and energy load, it's also a timer for the light's operation. Next up is the solar array. It's a group of photovoltaic panels, or solar cells. The technician sets the solar array front side down on the workbench. He threads cable through an aluminum back panel. This cable will serve as a ground wire. He pushes a pop rivet through a hole beside the cable and slides the eyelet on the end of the cable over it. He then pulls the pin through the rivet. He threads wires from the panel junction box into the opening beside the ground cable. He tucks them into a flexible cable at the back. He rivets the aluminum backplate to the solar panel array. He pulls the wires from the junction box through holes in a cover. He solders electrical pins to the ends of the wires and plugs them into a single connector. With the junction box cover installed, the solar streetlight system is ready for final testing. The team assembles the streetlight to a pole in the factory. They connect everything and stuff the wires into the pole's cavity. They screw the LED light fixture to the bracket on the pole, and it's ready to shine. The street lamp controller senses when it's dark and automatically illuminates. It will also detect a well-lit environment and switch the light off. Now that's street smarts.